It's Tuesday, June 14th, 7 p.m. This is the Board of Selectmen meeting. I'll call the meeting to order. And we will begin, as usual, with public input. Do I have any public input? Only once. Only twice. Gentlemen, Otley. Stand up and identify yourself and your address.
My name is Otley Thorson, regarding item 13, the Boxboro 241. And the commentary on that actually happened in the last application that is brought up.
Yes, there'll be a chance. It's not a hearing, but I'll definitely, if anybody in the audience wants to speak on it at that time, I'll allow that. Do you want to say something brief, Otley?
Yeah, I actually opposed quite significantly even the thought process of putting a subdivision or a development with multiple houses on a property behind me. I live at 243 Boxboro Road. And that subdivision or property that you guys are thinking about developing in the back over there would have a shared driveway with me. I purchased the land and or the house there 2 years ago with the intent of only seeing a single neighbor in the back there. And I actually talked to Susan earlier this year about purchasing the land behind her, not to have a significant number of neighbors surrounding me. And that's the point of living in Stow. Therefore, as a consequence of that, I'm actually very, very concerned about thinking about purchasing that land and turning that into a multi-dwelling site at the same time when I look at, for instance, realtor.com, and the price of land in Stow doesn't make this any unusually cheap or more expensive than other land here.
Oddly, I'm going to ask if you could save the bulk of your remarks for when this item is on the agenda, because then there'll be other people here, such as the chairman of SMOT, who can benefit from your remarks.
Yeah, I appreciate that.
Okay.
Could you give our administrative secretary the spelling of your last name, too?
Pardon?
Just spell your last name, please.
T-H-O-R-A-R-E-N-S-E-N.
Thank you.
Thank you, Otley. Any other public comment? Seeing none, the chairman traditionally makes remarks. Since our last meeting, I just want to comment on the passing of Barbara Seipler. Barbara Seipler, she achieved a lot in her very long life. She passed away shortly after our last meeting. And whether as a member of the Stow Historical Society, as a business owner, as a fixture at a small farm, whether as a member of the Ancient Documents Committee, whether as a member of the Lower Village Use Committee, she succeeded in what so many of us aspire to, which is to have an impact on your community, to be remembered well by those who knew you, and to live a long and valuable life. So rest in peace, and Barbara, thank you for everything you shared with us. I do think a moment of silence would be in order. Thank you. And now proceeding with some minutes. Maureen, you've got a few sets of minutes here. Thank you very much for that. And we have an open session, folks. We're just doing the open session minutes in open session. We have the May 24th minutes and the ones from March 22nd. I think we'll take up the May 24th first. So I have comments on the May 24th open session minutes.
I just have one section maybe for clarification. First page, third line from the bottom. By the potential buyer, Jennifer Henderson, then period, then Patrick Holmes, potential buyer. Are there two potential buyers, or was it one or the other?
Domestic partners.
Ah. Okay.
I think it's okay the way it is.
Okay.
Any other comments?
Sure.
Seeing and hearing none, do I have a motion on the May 24th minutes?
I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes of May 24th, 2016 as written.
Do I have a second on that motion?
Second.
Motion made and seconded to accept the minutes of May 24, 2016 as written. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. Extensions. And that's approved. And comments on the March 22nd, 2016 open session minutes.
I was good with those.
Seeing and hearing no comments, is there a motion?
I'll make a motion that we accept the minutes of March 22nd, 2016 as written.
I made a typographical change, just as amended.
Could I get a second and then you could describe it?
Hey, is it necessary, is it going to be the chair's practice? We haven't done this for so long. Can we submit our typos or?
That's a good question. I think if you have the opportunity, submit typos and things like that to Maureen ahead of time.
And therefore, it's not necessary to go over them in open session?
Yeah, if they're, I think I can trust everyone's discretion. If they're non-substantive, we don't need to waste time on that. That's a good question.
And if they are something, kick them back to me.
There you go. Everyone okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I'm still waiting for a second on the...
Second.
Thank you. Motion made and seconded to approve the minutes of March 22nd open session as drafted with minor amendments to come. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. Abstentions. And those are approved. And we are, of course, a few minutes shy of our next agenda item, which always happens. We have to start listing these hearings at 7:05 rather than 7:10 because we never managed to fill up quite 10 minutes.
How about this appointment of the town clerk? I don't think that that's...
You don't think that's controversial?
I don't think that's controversial.
I don't know. That could be a long discussion. Is she here?
She's not here. That's
not
one
here. Even more reason to do it while she's not here. Do I have... she's going to watch the tape, too. Discussion on the reappointment of Linda Hathaway to the position of town clerk. Linda had asked to do this ahead of the other appointments just so she's ready for the onslaught, then she can get all that done in case we have any substantive issues. Comments on the reappointment?
I think she's been doing a fine job, and I'm sure she will continue to do a fine job.
Do I have a motion?
I move to reappoint Linda Hathaway to the position of town clerk for a 3-year term ending June 30th, 2019.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to reappoint Linda Hathaway to the position of town clerk for a 3-year term ending June 30th, 2019. All those in favor, please signify. Well, further discussion? Seeing and hearing none. Other than that, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
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 Opposed, nay. Abstentions? And that's unanimous. And I think this is close enough. I'm willing to risk the wrath of the Attorney General over 1 minute. I'm going to call to order a public hearing on the transfer of a liquor license for Stow Acres Country Club and invite those affected and making the application to join us at the table. I think we were introduced last time, but I want to get the names again.
Jill Mann.
Jim Salvi.
Tom Ryan.
Dave Carlson.
We know each other.
Dave Carlson.
It's Dave.
Peter Brown.
Counselor. I can just wave to you.
Sorry about that. Dave Carlson. Nice to meet you.
Jim Brown. Okay, I'm reading the opening.
All right, then I have to read. I'm going to read the notice that was put in the local paper. Notice is hereby given under Chapter 138 of the General Laws that Stow Food Services, Inc., 58 Randall Road, Stow, has applied for a transfer of liquor license to Stow Food and Beverage, LLC. A public hearing will be held on the license transfer application on Tuesday, June 14, 2016 at 7:10 p.m. in the Stow Town Building, 380 Great Road, Stow, Massachusetts, and signed by me. And that is what we are here to do. Council, at least I assume you'll be opening. Do you want to do a brief description of, maybe you describe what we're doing here tonight, and for those following along at home, how it differs from what we discussed last time?
Most certainly. Good evening, Jill Mann here on behalf of Stow Food and Beverage, LLC, the petitioner in connection with a transfer of a liquor license from the current holder, which is Stow Food Services, Inc. This evening, we're actually here to secure an approval from this board to transfer that license to this new entity. The last time we were here simply to discuss the continued operation of the golf course and the food and beverage service by the current and then licensee, which is the food service, Stow Food Services, Inc. And that entity is controlled and operated and owned by Walter Lankow, which I'm sure people know since he's been operating here for decades. So at this point in time, Stow Food and Beverage and the agent here on behalf of that entity is Peter Brown to my right. In addition is David Carlson. I know a lot of people who visit the golf course know David because he too has been at the golf course for, I think, decades, two of them. And David is going to be the, if you will, general manager, head of golf, as well as the appointed licensed manager under the liquor license. In connection with that, we did provide this board with a query with his personal information, with a resume for the past 10 years, which included Stow Golf Course. In addition, I don't remember if we submitted his old tip certification form. We always submit them for the manager, so I'll give that to Maureen to have in the file. It's just whenever you're holding a liquor license and you're responsible for actually overseeing and ensuring that the rules and regulations are adhered to, the insurance companies do require that you actually have tip certification, and Mr. Carlson does. Mr. Brown does as well. As part of the application package, we too are responsible for providing you with all the detailed information regarding the transferee. And what you have in your package is, again, a query, so criminal record requests for information on the sole principal and owner of Stow Food and Beverage, John Swansburg. And that's in your file. And it also includes a personal information statement, again, about Mr. Swansburg. He does hold a couple of other liquor licenses, and this is not his first time being vetted by the ABCC. He does hold a license presently in Georgetown and has held others in various other places. And that basically is the summation of the application for transfer.
Thank you.
You're very welcome.
I'll first take questions from board members and then open it up to members of the public. Board members have questions on for Attorney Mann or I think it's Peter or David?
Yes.
Peter.
On this? That's right.
I think I recall seeing a note that there should be an affidavit of continuation of,
I believe that has been
as a golf course, and that's been filed.
Has that been recorded or just
it is
prepared?
Simply filed. I don't know that it requires filing. I don't think it does. I think every year you can file the lien gets re-upped.
I will leave that.
It's up to the assessor.
Due diligence requires at the first stage for this that the assessors have received and accepted, which they have. In fact, there's four separate affidavits because there's one required for each piece of property involved. And Kristen Fox, who's our principal assessor, informed me today that she had received what had been requested. This is essentially a form that was provided to them from the assessor's office, and it complies under the statute and DOR, and they've executed and had it notarized properly, and Kristen is good with the four pieces.
So what we're talking about essentially are affidavits that are fairly typical when a property changes hands, that the property will continue to be used as a golf course, basically, and to continue to enjoy the favorable tax benefits that it has historically enjoyed as a golf course. And there was, do appreciate your working so closely with town council and with our office to get everything right, including the proper book and page numbers and other things, and appreciate that. Any other questions? Mr. Burke.
I'll be brief. You know, last time you guys were before us, I was on your side. I want to encourage the continued use of this facility for golfing. We're very pro-business here in Stowe to the extent that we can be. I think that you should be congratulated on getting the license transfer. I gotta say though, after that selectmen's meeting, I went in to check out the rates for golf, and I just happened to ask, well, how's Walter Lankow? And the guy behind the desk said he hasn't seen Walter Lankow in months. I just think that, you know, we should get, you know, I know Dave, I haven't seen him in many years, but I'm, you know, counting on you guys to follow the rules and be responsible business owners. We're very pro-business to responsive business owners. I just wanted to get that out, and I'm willing to let it pass.
Well, if I understand correctly, the way you're doing it now is a little bit neater than what was proposed before. This is, it's your license.
Assuming
this gets approved, it's your license. It's not Walter's license that you are operating under, or he's operating under with your permission.
Oh, no, no. This is, Walter's license is gone, and it completely transfers in the new.
Yep. Yeah, that's fine.
Questions from any members of the public? Nancy?
Is there a time limit on the affidavit that was submitted for use as a golf course? Is it for a period of time?
Actually, the purpose stated on the affidavit is that at the moment of sign and until such time as the use changes, upon which by statute they need to notify us of that intent, then they have the conveyance of the back taxes and other things. That's essentially, they're affirming that it's going to continue in the future as its current use, and any change, they're responsible for informing us in advance they intend to convert the use.
That's for tax purposes only.
I just have one more question. And I know in the last meeting there was going to be some involvement of Walter in the operations. Is he still involved or not involved?
Would you like to answer? Yes, please.
So Walter continues to be involved until the ABCC approves? It's his license until the approvals go through. So if this board sees fit to approve it this evening, it then goes, Mr. Philip, Trunfio. Mm-hmm. See, I can't say it. Ms. Trunfio will actually send the Form 43 over to the ABCC. They'll execute, and then it'll be effective immediately, and they'll be transitioning the ownership.
Any other questions from members of the public? I had one or two late arrivals. Was that a Courtney? No. Oh, I'm sorry, sir. Could you state your name for the record, even though I let Nancy Arsenal at Redacre Road slide on that?
Jim Irvin, 12 Foxglove Lane. My question is, this might have already been stated, but could you please reiterate why the Stowickers Country Club is seeking to have the liquor license? Is it to serve liquor drinks on like the golf course, or is that
at the restaurant? Do you want to?
Of course. It's to simply continue the operation as presently used. So it is to continue the restaurant, to continue the snack shack, to continue the function, to continue service of the golf course. So it's simply to continue that which is currently operational.
Right. They've had a restaurant liquor license for some number of years.
Oh, yeah.
Any other questions? I just want to, Mr. Ryan.
I was just going to say, David Carlson is going to be the holder of the liquor license.
Yes, sir. The manager, yes.
The manager. One of the things I've noticed is, at least on your website, there's a John Ferring, who's the food and beverage manager. I take it he'll be reporting to you.
Yes.
And so he'll be basically running the food and beverage, but...
And managing the staff.
And managing the staff, yep. But under your direct supervision.
Yes, sir.
As the holder. Now, you're not a principal in the golf course.
No.
So if you were to leave, you would basically have to give up the liquor license, right?
May I ask
it to be transferred. I'm just trying to.
The way it works with the managers is the managers are simply an employee, and they're designated as a responsible party under the license. If and when, we hope it doesn't happen, David were to choose to leave, he simply gives us notice of a cessation of employment and they file for a change of manager, and it's a separate set of forms, but it does not cause the license to go into abeyance or to require to be transferred. Only the manager shift.
So to put it in caveman terms that I can understand, unlike what we talked about last time, this is not contingent on any one individual being associated with the enterprise.
John Swansburg it is. So if he were to change, we would have to have a full-blown hearing.
Okay.
If a manager were to change, you don't even have to legally advertise it. It's simply just demonstrating that person is of upstanding character.
Oh, well, because it's not an Inc., it's an LLC.
Yes.
Got it.
Right. The licensee will actually be Stow Food and Beverage LLC, just the manager, David Carlson.
Correct. Yes.
Other questions? Ms. Hageman?
None.
Oh, you were looking at me while you had a question.
Okay. Oh, sorry.
And I noticed one other thing too is that it looks like all the abutters were supposed to be notified of this hearing, probably.
Yes. And And so the abutter notification, I deliver an affidavit, and I delivered that to Ms. Trinfio. And there's a, if you want to show them, there's a stark, I had to give her the green cards. So I just gave her green card stack this big because it's 300 acres. So we notified an awful lot of people.
So there are occasions when we read the list of abutters who were notified, but we're not doing that this time. But along those lines, anyone else want to say something? Any abutters want to say something? Any other member of the public?
Seeing nothing, Mr. Chair, I move.
I just want to make one comment. I just want to, very happy that you are choosing this, I'll say, more straightforward route than what we were talking about last time. This is terrific. Thank you so much. As chair, I have some insight into all the work you've put in recent days and weeks with our town council and with our office. Thank you very much for doing all that. Welcome to Stow. And you are taking over what I think can honestly be called the jewel in this community. I don't play golf, at least not yet, but it is a beautiful property. I attended a golf school there. I can figure out how I did in golf school by the fact that I don't play, but it is simply a wonderful, wonderful, beautiful property. I hope you're taking it on terms that allow you to make a lot of money in the years to come, and that you enjoy being here as much as I think we're going to enjoy having you here operating the golf course. And with that, I think a motion is in order.
I apologize for being premature with it, but at the chair's pleasure, I move that the public hearing for transfer of liquor license for Stow Acre Country Club be closed.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to close the public hearing on the transfer of the Stow Acres liquor license. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, nay. Abstentions. And now a motion on the actual transfer of the license is in order.
I move to appoint, excuse me, I apologize. I start again. I move to approve the transfer of the liquor license of Stow Food Services, Inc. to Stow Food and Beverage, LLC, DBA Stow Acres Country Club, as described in the application received May 16, 2016, and subject to the stipulations that the applicant will update information to the original application and final approval by the Massachusetts Alcoholic Beverages Control Commission.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded to transfer the Stow Acres liquor license as described. Further discussion. All those in favor, but seeing and hearing none, all those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, nay. Abstentions. Thank you very much and congratulations.
We have to do the common victuals.
Oh, it's common victuals.
We do have to do the common victuals. Yeah.
Just like in the Beverly Hillbillies, they're called victuals.
I know.
And Maureen, thank you for the pronunciation hint of that. We've been calling it victualers. And I don't believe that on the common victualers license transfer that this is a hearing. I think this is just a discussion and then presumably a vote. So is there any discussion among members of the board on the transfer of the common victualers license?
Board of Health was all set with everything, as I recall from the last meeting, and fire department, everybody's good with it.
Anybody in the public want to make a comment? This is the transfer license served food. At least that's how I understand.
Yes.
So I don't think it's actually a transfer. I think it's just a
new It's a new license.
It's a new license. Thank you, Mr. Ryan. Further discussion. Seeing and hearing none, I think a motion is in order.
I move to approve the common
Vittler.
License.
Whatever you're comfortable
Stow
with.
Stow Food. Yeah. Stow Food and Beverage, LLC, DBA, Stow Acres Country Club, 58 Randall Road, effective immediately and expiring December 31, 2016, and subject to annual renewal thereafter.
Second.
Motion's been made and seconded to grant a common, I don't have the motions in front of me, a common victualer's license as so described. To approve common victualer's license for Stow Acres Country Club. Effective immediately expiring December 31, 2016, and subject to annual renewal thereafter. Further discussion. Seeing and hearing none. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. Abstentions. Now, thank you very much and congratulations.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thanks for your patience.
Thank you very much.
Can I pick this up tomorrow? We'll have it ready.
So, Maureen, before the release, we have to sign, what exactly do we have to sign?
Oh, 43, yeah.
And that.
Right. Thank you very much. We appreciate your time.
Thank you.
And we look forward to seeing everybody at the golf course.
Yes. And I do not have a paper agenda, which is really hampering me.
Don't worry about it.
You're the best, Mr. Burke.
Just don't ask me for a pen.
So, our next, I brought a pen. Our next order of business is to discuss the appointment of the Town Building Space Use Feasibility Study Committee. Who would like, oh, Ms. Hathaway, bad news. You were already reappointed. Congratulations.
You know, it'll, I'm 16 years in July I started, and so this will put me up to 19 years.
Congratulations. And sorry to do it without you, but.
That's okay. I knew I couldn't get here until 7:20.
Who would like to lead this discussion? The Town Administrator? Is Mr. Hyde here?
But I would, I think in my activities report, I mentioned that he had a prior commitment.
Oh, okay.
And I think at the same time, I offered for the board's consideration in his absence that he be appointed for one of many reasons. The most important is that this feasibility, future feasibility study for space use of the town buildings, which is a thought that I had begun to develop about a year ago, is that anything that proceeds post that recommendation or improvements to those buildings will be managed under that department where he's assistant facility manager. So I think it's critical that he be on that. Having said that, you have 7 slots to fill and you have 7 applicants. So, and unless there was, there's 7 now.
Okay.
So you have 7 openings, 7 slots. In the interest of time, you can either decide to ask of, in all but one of these folks, I think, are well known to us, so it's up to you whether you want to go through that process or not.
So, our applicants are Dan Nicholson, Jerry Kunst, Marilyn Zaborski, Dot Spaulding, Jesse Stedman, the planner. I don't know if that's official. Oh, thank you. Doug Hyde and Linda Hathaway. Kathy Sferrer withdrew. That's also why I can chair this. but that's not why, by the way. I didn't have a, don't want to leave that implication.
We would have asked you to leave first. No.
Of those, how many of those folks are here tonight? Okay, several. Excellent. Gentlemen and lady, as Bill said, I wasn't anticipating individual interviews, since we have 7 people for 7 spots. If you desire otherwise, then that's what we'll do. Does anyone desire to do 7 interviews?
yes, of course. I know. You know, I think the applicant should be offered an opportunity to speak to us if they want. And just a point of information, I directed to the town administrator. Are there going to be associate members?
Under the rules of our governance, associate members are left to the full members to decide. It's also true that the appointing authority up front, if they wish to, and we've done this in the past where we had a number of applicants exceeding the number of membership, and the board right off the get-go after interviewing had offered one the membership and one would you agree to serve as an associate, and you made that appointment. But the default position in town is that the once the committee is chosen, the full members can add associate members at their wish.
On that point, I would just leave it to the members of the study committee, as it's eventually constituted, to consider associate members and also to consider, and hopefully the people at home and who read about this meeting will also consider about applying to be associate members. It's a great way to serve the town, and associate members, in my experience, are treated almost the same as members.
And the the main purpose of this committee is as certain town departments move down to Pompo, we're going to have some vacant and unused town buildings here in the town center, most notably the fire station. So the point of this committee is to figure out what to do with that, the extra space in the town building, some space in the town hall, things like that. We have several representatives from the Historical Society or Historical Commission. Jerry represents the Cemetery Commission. And we have other interests. Jesse, I was the town planner, Doug from the Building Department. Linda.
Historical.
I was going to say her historical interest and her interest in town hall. As Mr. Burke indicated, would any of the soon-to-be members of this committee like to say anything about their interest or their desire to serve? Thank you. And on behalf of the board, we appreciate your stepping forward. This is a really important committee, and it's got some important work to do fairly quickly. And we appreciate your stepping up to do this and to help us all out on these questions.
Well, I think it's important to note, too, that these are all people that are already heavily involved. And thanks for taking the extra time. So.
With that, I think a motion would be in order.
I move to appoint the following seven members to the Town Building Space Use Feasibility Study Committee and to designate them as special municipal employees to serve indefinite terms until final recommendations are presented to the Board of Selectmen. Those seven being Linda Hathaway, Doug Hyde, Jerry Kunst, Dan Nicholson, Dot Spalding, Jesse Stedman, and Marilyn Zaworski.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to appoint the seven individuals so named to the Town Building Use Feasibility
Study Committee.
Study Committee. Further discussion? Seeing and hearing none. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. Abstentions? Thank you very much for stepping forward on this important committee. Thank you.
We look forward to receiving your recommendations.
And I'm there to help for everything but money.
Unless you find any in the old buildings, then you turn it over.
We'll be getting a schedule.
Yeah, Doug Hyde, the Facility Management Department is going to run the process. Doug will be sending out notices for your get started meeting, kickoff meeting, and set some agendas and some deliverables that you got to your past.
At some point, would you also make a plug that we need board members for a lot of committees, not just associates?
I'm sorry, Chairman's comments have passed.
Okay.
Ms. Hathaway, you were here. No, Linda makes a good point. We need town volunteers, not just for this committee, but for a lot of other committees, both elected and appointed. It's bad to see the same 40, 45 faces over and over again. And it would be terrific to get some new blood. I see some faces I don't see at every meeting, so that's a good sign. So if you're interested in getting at all more involved, some positions take a decent amount of time, and some really fit easily into spare time. And the town clerk often holds a sort of open house for appointed and elected boards. When's the next one coming up? Probably in the spring?
Yeah, in the spring.
Yeah.
And info is on the website as far as for committees and what we're looking for.
And if there's a committee you're interested in getting involved in, all you do is you call the chair. The chair's name is on the website. You call them up and you talk to them about it. That's probably how all of us got involved in town.
Really, if you're interested and you don't even want to talk to them to begin with, just go show up at the meetings, listen, see what they're doing. Most of the committees are happy to take input and let you be involved in the discussion.
And then maybe one day you'll be able to consider fascinating things such as our next item, one day liquor license for the retirement party for Karen Keller. Is someone interested in Jesse? Are you interested in talking about this? Do you still want it? Good morning. Do you, one day I'd like to figure out who needs a one-day liquor license and who doesn't need a one-day liquor license, and what exactly the rules are, but...
But we're not going to worry about that.
We're not going to worry about that now. So are you folks, you guys are still interested in this for Carol?
Yeah, to the extent it's necessary, it was one of those things we didn't really know, so I decided to put it forward so that we weren't left stranded come the day of. So, it, you know, after reading the statute, it's a little confusing. It does seem like it was more geared towards somebody who might be actually serving, taking money for a drink at like a bar setting, and that's why they ask you to go through a wholesaler.
Whereas you guys are just...
Whereas we're, there's going to be coolers, and it's all going to be part of the package. And so what we're going to try to do is just contact some of the wholesalers and do what needs to be done and see if we can just get it that way.
Okay.
I mean, that's the plan, yeah.
By the way, I hope Karen's party isn't a surprise because you know this is on TV.
It was impossible to do a surprise.
He knows too much.
Yeah.
All right. So I don't, I think everyone's, I think there's application materials in here. Any further discussion or questions about the one-day liquor license for the current town planner's retirement party? Seeing none, I think a motion is in order.
Mr. Chairman, I move to approve and sign a special one-day liquor license for the retirement party for town planning. Town Planner Karen Kelleher to be held at Honey Pot Hill Orchard on Friday, June 24th. Between 4 and 8 p.m.
And to waive the fee?
And to waive the fee thereof. How's that?
So do I have a second?
Second.
Nope. I had to think about it for a while.
No, I defer to my... To our newest colleague.
Ms. Hageman has the second.
I
defer.
Further discussion. Seeing and hearing none. All those in favor of issuing a one-day liquor license for the retirement party for Karen Kelleher to be held on June 24th?
June 24th.
Yes.
Please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. Abstentions. Thank you. That's approved.
Can I just make a general comment with regard to the necessity or not of that one-day liquor license? I believe the ABCC did confirm that one is required, irrespective of whether it's for sale or not, and it might be the statute changed over the years. Having said that, it's still, for due diligence purposes, it's still a prudent idea to get the approval from the chief executive officers of the town. For insurance purposes, liability purposes, that alone, I would recommend you issue one, even if it weren't required.
Thank you, Bill. All right, next on our agenda is a discussion on the opening and the closing dates for the August 8th, 2016 special town meeting warrant. So I'm assuming we can take this subject up separate and apart from item 13, the working group on 241 Boxboro Road, because we have other reasons now to have a special town meeting.
We potentially have other reasons.
Potentially, okay, so we're going to open and close. Mr. Wrigley, do you want to say anything about this?
Only as much as, given the, not knowing how the outcome of the presentation this evening, report from the working group with regard to the winter property and the board concerning whether to exercise the threat of first refusal of Chapter 61, there are a couple of other interests the town has in having a special town meeting, though they're not as date sensitive as it would be under the statute for you being able to exercise your rights completely, which requires a town meeting vote and actually filing that vote with the registry within 120 days. So August 8th is the date we're working with here, simply to cover all bets, still not knowing the outcome of this process. The others will fit into that. So we're pegging it at August 8th to give us a few days to the August 12th deadline as per council's count of 120 days. Once we accepted what was an appropriate notice. So that's why we're, and obviously the window is narrow with regard to opening and closing the warrant so that we can proceed with the other process requirements to get a special town meeting held. So we'll work back from that date to back everything into it. So August 8th, with August 8th being there, and the need to hold a public hearing under the policy and the statute with regard to exercising your right if you choose to exercise. It's not, the hearing's not required if you choose not to. But if you came out of this meeting tonight thinking you heard
sufficient information from the town boards that you would want to further the due diligence to make that decision, then June 28th has been tentatively scheduled for the hearing. So that's been squeezed in there as well. Tight schedule, don't have a lot of time. We've got enough to make it, but we've got to be deliberate and with some deliberate speed exercising the process that we have. So it fits right now.
Let's just reiterate that June 28th is what we're currently aiming for the public hearing on 241 Boxboro Road. Just a point of information, usually the amount of time we have the warrant open for special town meetings is a lot shorter than for the annual town meeting. Annual town meeting is the town's main legislative session. Special town meetings should just be for things that can't wait until the spring. There ought to be fewer of those. And I think for a special town meeting in the dead of summer, we're particularly hoping to have a short warrant. Further discussion, Mr. Ryan.
I suppose I'm wondering why we're discussing it now versus after we discuss the, the 241 Boxboro Road, and what other items are we looking at potentially for the special town meeting? Because if we don't do this, would we be able to put them off till the fall?
One of them involves your building committee.
Right.
And the roof. My argument would be the sooner the better on that, if what I understand was the decision to replace the roof. I've been involved in a lot of construction projects. You get into the fall with a fall town meeting and trying to replace a roof that large, as the weather begins to be unpredictable, you don't control product and when it gets there, you don't control many things that you could end up trying to put a roof on in a bad time of year. You also have, understanding is that the OPM here, Craig, is going to do this, and I support this approach, rather than going out separately, to do this through a change order with the existing contractors. So the sooner you get that roofing contractor who's been here engaged in other matters and not running off on you, again, timing is going to be important. So I think the August date fits well. The furthest I would go is early September, if you're going to try to do it this year, if I understand what the committee voted, which is to replace the roof. Not a small job.
And the earlier the better is probably for that roof.
And then also, so you could decide that, and I'm being I'm assuming here that based on the information I know and that of our working group, that the board would not decide tonight, would not decide not to exercise your right, but would go at least to the public hearing. It is true that if you want to hear the presentation first to that effect, that's fine too. I mean, it's not important.
Well, what's the pleasure of the board? Are you comfortable?
Yeah, I'm fine with it. I just wanted to hear the.
I mean, personally, I'm comfortable because, and I thought the same thing, Tom. That's why I started off the way I did.
Mm-hmm.
We're going to need a special town meeting. August 8th, from the perspective of the building committee, is not a bad idea. I know it's unusual, but it's not a bad idea to do it then anyway. Mr. Burke.
Just point of information, are we on track to break the record for town meetings in 1 year?
No, because from some of the research my wife has done, there have been, maybe separate town meetings, but they used to have four or five sessions of an individual town meeting.
I will tell you, the first year I was appointed, we had one in July, and then we had another one in the fall.
I don't think you're even close. The year before I came here, 1991, you had seven or eight town meetings because you were balancing your budget at the ballot box because you didn't have the money to balance your budget otherwise. And there were 18 override requests, separate ones, occurring at multiple meetings, so you're not close.
Well,
point taken though, Mr. Burke. Not exactly a record we want to shoot for.
There's still time left in the air.
Yeah.
It may be that this is the only special town meeting. I don't have.
We already had one in February.
We're talking the fiscal year, though.
Oh, you're talking fiscal year. I was talking calendar.
Well, that's what I operate on. I don't,
For the discussion. Sorry.
I withdraw the comment of the.
For the discussion with the board members. Anybody? I'm good with being a board.
I'm fine.
Anybody in the audience got anything to say about this? Okay, therefore I think a motion is in order.
I move that the board set Monday, August 8, 2016, as a date for another special town meeting to be held at Hale Middle School, 55 Hartley Road, at 7 p.m., and I move that the board open the August 2016 special town meeting warrant on June 14, 2016, today, and close the warrant on June 21, 2016.
Second. Motion's been made and seconded to set the date for a special town meeting on August 8th, 2016, and to open the warrant for that meeting today and close it, what'd you say?
June 21st.
June 21st.
Meaning people have to get their warrant requests into the town by that date.
Right away. All those, I'm sorry, further discussion? Seeing and hearing none. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. I think that was unanimous. Yes. All right. Despite my loud protestations over the last week that we have a packed agenda, we're flying through this thing.
Fine job, Mr. Chairman.
Good job. Well, yeah.
Good job.
We're not done yet. Oh, yeah, we're not done. Right. We put all the easy stuff up front. So, next item on our agenda is the signing of the waiver of the Chapter 61 waiver for the Minuteman Realty Corp. Property. At the last meeting, we voted the waiver. We did not sign the document because something was missing. I think the book and page number was incorrect.
Correct.
Okay.
And
Maureen, do you want to report to the board on the status of that? Is that ready?
Sure. We were able to go online each day and look for the recording information. It came through today. So town council had drafted a waiver, and we just plugged in those book and page numbers, and it's ready to sign.
Do we need to take a motion, or can we just sign it?
That's a good question. I think having voted the waiver, we can just sign it, but...
I'm for taking the easy route and the quick one, so...
Yeah. We've already waived it.
Okay. Sign it.
Pass it on down.
Ms. Hegeman was not here. Should she? I think she can sign it, though, because she's just attesting to what the board...
She has the choice.
Here's the choice.
If I was new, I'd put it off just to see how this goes.
Yeah, I think you want to give this two or three meetings before you decide whether you trust us.
No, I'm going to follow it. Yeah,
counsel. Well, the less time your signature appears, the better.
We got three. That's
still a quorum, so.
Oh, it's still a quorum. I would sign if there was a quorum issue.
All right. I'm looking forward to this. The next item on our agenda is the discussion of the continued use of the word Pompositticut in the naming of the community center fire station. Mr. Ryan, I'll turn this over to you. Do you want to say a few words? Do you have anybody in the audience who wants to say?
Well, I think maybe have Dot and Marilyn come on up here and any other members of the historical commission, if they so care. You're just going to send Marilyn.
Hi, Marilyn.
Yeah, I've been appointed. And we created a little sign. We're visual learners.
That's pretty good.
That's Rosemary. Okay, since 1971, the name Pompositticut has been a very strong part of this town. We've seen the sign Pompositticut School going back and forth all these years. The sign was taken down just a year ago this time. Pompositticut means the land of many hills. If you think about Stow, we have Birch Hill, Pompositticut, Spindle, Flag Hill, Pilot Grove, Marble, Honeypot. I went on a topographical map, and there's Stevens, Lambert, and Boone Hills, also in Stow. It is the Nipmuc name for this region, which is thousands of years old. So since 1971, this name has been part of our students. It rolls right off their tongue. They knew it. We in the Historical Society have been going into the schools. It's third grade. It's a town history. And when we bring up the very 1681, how they spell Pompositticut, we would sounded out phonetically, the kids knew immediately what it was, and they understood. This year's third grade, this is the first time we have children who have never been in Pompositticut Elementary School. There's five classes in February. I was in every single class, and every single class, when we looked at the word, nothing happened. Then a few kids said, oh, that's Pompositticut. My older brother and sister went there, and the rest of the class went, what is that? What is that? And the teachers and I were going, oh my goodness, we are losing a vital part of our history. And so with that thought, we say we need the word Pompositticut for our community center, however you want to take, you know, the name, but we'd love to see it prominent on the sign so that when people go by, our name Pompositticut is going to be with us. And that's our spiel. And just to give you a visual of, you know, this was just, it's pretty cute. give you an idea of a sign. There's two entrances. I don't know how that works with two entrances, so that people know where to go, but the name of the area.
Thank you, Marilyn.
Thank you.
And just a point of information, signage is already part of the budget for the project. I'm kind of assuming that this is within the budget for the project. Discussion among board members about this.
I think it's a wonderful idea. I fully support it.
I would also. It's, you know, when we ended up getting the letter from Marilyn a number of months ago, I think it was March.
It was early March.
I thought it was a very nice idea to somehow do it. You know, I don't know if this, I'm sure, you know, you're willing to modifications to it, something like that.
I actually like this.
It's the Pompositticut. It's the word.
Right. That big. It's got to be that big. I like that. It's got to be that big.
I like that. I mean, I don't think you'd name a fire station. You know?
Could put at one entrance and fire station.
Right. I like Pompositticut Community Center. I think that. And then Stow Fire Department, Stow Council Agent. I like what you've got here. Mr. Burke.
Not to be crass and mercenary, has anyone offered money for naming rights, like Staples or?
Not to be crass or mercenary.
All right, admittedly being crass and mercenary.
The Brian Burke Community Center.
I don't have the money to put my name on this.
I actually had one suggestion that came in also today when they'd seen this item on the agenda was actually to name one of the rooms, the Pompositticut room or something like that. But I think that could be taken up later on. You know.
Well, let's stick with this. I think Marilyn's point is that, or one of Marilyn's points is that this name should be front and center on the street, not necessarily in a room. So,
right.
You know, maybe we can talk the Nipmucks into paying us to name the Pompositticut. That'll be a win-win for everybody. Any comment from members of the public on this? This is a community decision.
Well,
Linda?
My comment would be is that it's a community City Council on Aging Rec Commission Department kind of thing, too. So you might need a little bit more things on there. But definitely Pompositticut.
I can't think of why not. So, any other comment?
I think it's a great idea.
We won't build the sign if Staples or the DCU wants to get a hold of us. We won't build the sign right now. Just it's out there.
You know, the kids all learned a song when there was at school, so I was just wondering if we have to rewrite the song to include the community center. It's going to change the meter of the song, but
we're in charge of the music.
Well, I think one of the things that we're a tiny bit ahead in our agenda. Mr. Kopczynski, would you favor us with the song?
No. Well, I never went to the school.
You raised it. Who will favor us with the song?
I don't know.
And what's the meter?
Oh.
Okay.
One of the things is I had actually asked Craig Martin, the project manager, if they had a vision of what the signs were that they were going to put out there at this point. I think he didn't have them at the moment, but I would say that what we could probably do, especially since you're also chair of the building committee, we could say that we're in favor of this and try to put the spirit of this proposal into the sign.
Right.
How the building committee would...
Assuming we vote in favor of this, what I'm taking as an instruction is that the word Pompositticut has to be prominent at front and center outside in reference to the building as a whole or, you know, some substantial part of it. The rest of it is subject to some tweaking. Is that fair?
I think if the Pompositticut building stands separately and then the list of the actual offices, or I wouldn't combine the two because it's going to be difficult in size to still have prominent Pompositticut. That'll, you could probably have Pompositticut, I'm just going to use this a term, Pompositticut building standing separately, and then you have your list of the departments that are in the office and all of the rest on a different sign. There's plenty of room up front for that.
Mm-hmm. We'll figure it out. We got the basic marching orders. But I think need a motion.
Mr. Chair, do you have something written?
No.
I will make it up. Let's see. I'll make a motion that we request or instruct the Community Center Fire Station Building Committee to include the name Pompositticut on some of the signage out front.
Prominent.
Prominent signage out front, as you know, as appropriate.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to instruct the building committee to include the word Pompositticut prominently on the signage out front of the new Fire Station Community Center building. Further discussion? Seeing and hearing none. All those in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, nay. Abstentions? Thank you for bringing this to our attention.
Yeah, thank you very much. And
nice presentation.
Nice presentation, and thanks for putting the time into it. You're much more, I told you, you're much more creative than you were.
Speaking of visuals, I'd like to commend the highway department's work on the retaining wall.
Yes.
With those dressed up bricks.
Yes.
They did a good job.
Yeah.
Yes.
As they did over here in the lower parking area, they look sharp.
Yeah. No, this was, you know, being on the building committee, it's so easy to get focused on the details, you know, like the grease trap and the... the little things in the bay that need water, and it's good to be told to lift your eyes up and think a little bit long term. So thank you for bringing this to
the site's going to look
attention.
Good dressed up on this day.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
from 117. Or churched up is the term for some of this. Depends on the crowd you're in.
Thank you guys very much.
Thank you.
I'm going to take something out of order. I think I'm going to go to the working group on 241 Boxboro Road and postpone briefly the discussion about the Nashoba District, the joint representative on collective bargaining agreement, just because I know we have a lot of people here on the 241 Boxboro Road. I want to take care of that. Not sure how best to start this discussion off. I think I'll start with the town administrator, update us on the working group's discussions and what's been accomplished and where you are.
Under the Selectmen's policy for considering Chapter 61 property and the possibility of voting to exercise or not the right of first refusal, I am prominently named, and I want to thank the working group that put my name in there for this. Gunn was on that committee, but so anyway, this is the first opportunity I had to exercise that as the chair of the working group. So after our last meeting, I sent out not only to the working, those of the, what I call it, the rapid response team, which is the first step that collects all the raw data from the various departments, put it in plain view, provide it to the board. That's the kickoff of the process. The selectmen then decide their first opportunity whether to go to the next step, which would be to get more information if there was enough interest expressed by any one or more of our departments, which there was. And so I then had a blast email sent out, not only to that group, but others that I thought might have some interest in sharing thoughts with regard to whether the town, through its selection, ought to consider exercising the right to purchase. I did that. I then asked folks from the rapid response team to meet with me, which we did last week, to get any additional thoughts. Clearly, when we left our last meeting, Smart had expressed interest, specifically a possible affordable housing project, which is what they do, and they're under the provisions that have been created locally for it. And I think there was consensus that they should get the opportunity to try to develop a proposal to bring before the board at its next meeting. Prominent in that, the Smart group went to the CPC submitting an application that was entertained last night for help with funding of the purchase and perhaps beyond the purchase of it. That meeting was held. The results of that meeting will be explained to you tonight by representatives from both the CPC and SMART. But the consensus we got from our working group meeting was that this should go forward, that affordable housing is important. CPC funding obviously recognized that importance. The CPA Act itself only provided three eligible activities for funding under the CPA Act and the funds that come in locally and matched by the state, and that is affordable housing, historically significant projects, that's my term, I know there's probably something else they call it, and then open space recreation. So, and I offered my own opinions that day, that I think finding affordable living space for folks to share in Stow, what Stow has to offer as a community, is pretty important. And I think that's why it was identified in the statewide act. And if you want money, that's something to do. We haven't ourselves, through our only real active housing agency, SMART, done our own affordable housing. There's been fits and starts. We've come a long way. They've done a lot of work trying to identify property and help. But for one reason or another, either some other use was assigned for property that we either owned or recently purchased, or even those that are held privately. And I'd simply voiced my interest that, A, I think this property is well suited for that, and that suitability is one of the, in the policy, one of the identified items that you have to look at, and that has to be prepared by those who are advocating it, and then funding is the other one. And we clearly, through the CPC, have funding for affordable housing. SMART has its own funding. And I think if there was a joint venture between the two, and hopefully they can explain to you guys, I think there's probably some consensus to go forward with a joint venture for purchasing. All the details may not have been worked out yet, but they have a meeting scheduled for 27th. And so with that, I would hand it over to both the CPC. I know Courtney, the chair, is here, and Michael's here from SMART. And maybe Courtney could start as chair of the CPC to explain what took place last night, and then Michael can follow, and then questions by the board can follow after that.
I'll probably have, actually after the two of you speak, I'll probably have comment from anybody in the audience who wants to speak, and then comment questions from the members of the board. But Courtney?
So the CPC was able to reach a consensus that we are in favor of this project and willing to support it at some level. We have a range, I would say, of support. So we voted for a certain amount to definitely to support buying the parcel, which is not a house lot in itself, and other associated costs with the project. I would say that our conversation is not entirely complete, and we may continue to refine our decision on this. So, but we're in support of purchasing the land.
Can you be any more specific about
this? A lot of hems and haws there, Courtney.
No.
Did you take a vote?
Yes, we took. I should speak more frankly. As chair of the committee, I would like to see our support perhaps extend further than we voted last night. And our vote was to bring an article to town meeting for $80,000 of the $210,000 that was requested of us. And I believe it's possible for us to do better because affordable housing is really important to the town. I've always been a strong advocate of preserving open space, but building affordable housing is another way of preserving open space, because by achieving our 10% inventory, we will no longer have developments that we can't control easily coming into town. So it's a subtle point, but aside from the fact that I believe that people of all sorts should have a right to live in a lovely town like ours at different levels of income and different sized dwellings and types of dwelling units, I also feel strongly about that.
So recognizing that you, that it's a dynamic process and that you as an individual and as chair may want to go beyond wherever this, whatever the CPC voted, I'm still not clear what they voted. You said 80,000.
They voted $40,000 to cover the cost of purchasing the, so there are two parcels in this,
right,
in question. There is a parcel that would be easy to buy and sell because it is a hammerhead lot that is approved by the planning board. It has been sold by the original owner, purchased by the current owner, and put up for sale again, which brings us to the place we are now. The second parcel is the back land on these owners' own property. And CPC actually voted to cover the purchase price of that parcel, back land, and all associated costs with the project that we were being asked for, which is, we actually revised the number from 30,000 to 40,000. So the sum total of our support that we voted last night was 80,000.
And what did CPC vote with regard to the first parcel?
Didn't specifically have a vote on that one way or the other. Our conversations led to a motion to expend $80,000 in this way. And part of the conversation was about whether purchasing this land would restrict its use in some way, so that we may have just gotten bogged down in a particular detail, but by purchasing the land with CPA funds, the town has to use it for CPA use. So if for any reason this excellent idea were not to go forward, the town would still have to keep this land and use it, just let it sit, or use it for open space, or use it for affordable housing, or some historic, which probably wouldn't fit. So our feeling was that we might be encumbering by
funding.
By funding.
Do board members feel clear on this, on, I guess, the CPC's position and Courtney's statement about it being a dynamic problem? Do board members have any questions for Courtney?
I suppose, and it may go to the larger part of it, is my understanding that, you know, it was, $180,000, 140 for one parcel, 40 for the other, and so we're kind of 100K shy.
No, 30. So we were, the application was for 210,000. So it's 180 plus $30,000 of associated costs.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, you're right. We're more than 100K shy. So this is why I would actually like to have a further conversation with the rest of the committee at our meeting on June 27th. And
was there anything,
what we can do.
Was there anything about development costs?
Also had a conversation about development costs, but that is pure speculation at this point. There are various things that could happen which it's pretty hard for anybody to foresee. SMOT is, they'll talk about the fact that they're currently having further engineering studies of the land, but you know, at the moment, it's premature to talk about development costs. So.
Unless board members have questions for Courtney, I'll go to Mike.
Yeah, I'd say go to Mike.
Mike, do you want to
interrupt some of what I'm thinking?
Sure. So, holding aside the CPC part, what also we've been looking at is for the feasibility of the study. So, on parcel three, which is the Hammerhead lot, we reviewed the engineering studies that had gone on in the past in terms of the percolation tests and the site topology as far as we knew it, and that looks, there's nothing in that information that would dissuade us from that it's a good building site. There was no ledge that was, there might be ledge there, but it wasn't found during the engineering studies. The percolation test went well. There's some issues about the driveway, but it's all stuff that's already kind of included in the permit that was already issue for the single dwelling. There's already a permit for a single dwelling hammerhead lot there that's already extended. So we also engaged the same engineers to look at the second piece so that we could understand what the qualities were there for that other piece, whether we wanted to look at both those pieces and what the issue was, whether there was, we heard from the current owner that there was a possibility of ledge there and some other things. So that has gone ongoing, but we wouldn't necessarily, depending on how those things went, we wouldn't necessarily need to build on that second lot. That second lot might be just for well and septic and other infrastructure type issues. So there wouldn't be not necessarily, maybe all the buildings would be on three. If that was an issue, or if that comes out well, we might spread it out more. And so, we have no concept at this point. We're just talking about the land acquisition at this point. But we believe that it makes a lot of sense for at the price point and location, size of the property. Just it makes a lot of sense to go forward.
Do you anticipate by the time of the public hearing or the town meeting on August 8th? Having more detail about where money would come from for construction or to have a pro forma?
No.
So you don't have any of that?
Not in time for June 20th. We don't even know the number of units are available, any of those possibilities. So, and there may be more than, we are at this point looking at the land acquisition only. And to look at the feasibility of building there, but nothing about there's what the range of potential units could be or how many bedrooms the land could support. That's what we'll be looking at from an engineering perspective, but in terms of how that breaks down into the number of units or the number of buildings and that sort of stuff, in 120 days, it's just not enough to deal with.
So you don't plan on having that by town meeting either? Okay. Can you explain in any more detail the financing question? I mean, what I'm taking away is that CPC voted a certain amount of money. SMOT's going to try to talk about it more, which is fine. Is that roughly?
I think that was CPC's position. I mean, I can't speak for them. We asked for the whole purchase price, right. And they have their own deliberations to decide what to do. I think if I'll try to characterize some of the concerns was that since building three, I mean, a lot of parcel three is a buildable lot now and is a permitted lot. The idea would be that if it was purchased with CPC funds, that if this project didn't go forward, it would need to be sold. If it were like we couldn't recover any costs of that, we couldn't resell it unless it had restrictions on it for whatever restriction, whether it was open space, or for affordable housing, and that wouldn't be possible. It would give the town more options. For SMOT to buy that parcel with its own funds so that it could be resold as it is currently as a building lot, currently permitted, if the affordable housing if more extensive affordable housing, for what reason, you know, for funding or for other reasons, that project didn't go forward, they would still be able to recover some of those funds, and there would be no restrictions on it. So I believe that, is that fair?
It is. I'd like to add one thing, which is that if we were to, so we just sort of got stuck on this, and that's how our conversation went. But if we were to buy, if we were to fund this project out of unrestricted funds, then it would only be, then the parcel, if you wanted to resell it, for instance, would only be restricted to the CPA uses. But again, so if SMOT buys the easy to resell parcel out of their own funds, they could apply to us later, and you know, as part of an additional project to actually build units there and recoup that cost. Meanwhile, if everything just went kablooey, they could resell that parcel without encumbrance. We would have to restrict, we'd have to put either an affordable housing restriction on it, a conservation restriction on it, and those are the two that...
Even if you use unrestricted funds?
Yes.
Even if you use, okay. If it was resold.
So, and I think it's good you've raised this, and I mean, as a member of SMOT or a former member of SMOT, whatever I am right now.
Transitional memory.
I want to get this out there. It is a possible scenario, to the extent SMOT buys this with its own funds and not restricted CPA funds, it's a possible scenario SMOT just sells it and takes that money,
right,
puts it in the Affordable Housing Trust. The money eventually gets used for affordable housing, okay, somewhere else.
Right. We would be restricted to an affordable housing use, but we would not be restricted into, you know, SMOT has the capability,
but under that scenario,
bylaws to be able, right, to buy and sell property with the advice of the Select Board and FinCom.
Under that scenario, and would SMOT come back to the Select Board and FinCom before selling it? I do think that's
right. Important. For any transfer property, buying or selling, in our bylaws, we ask for advisory votes from the Select Board.
Advisory votes, okay. But under that scenario, 241 could be sold for something other than affordable housing?
Correct.
Okay.
But the proceeds have to be used for home.
Let me get questions from the, unless it's germane to that.
It is kind of, because now the source of the funds that you have now came out of CPC, didn't they not?
No. They were in lieu, the original funding was in lieu funds for Arbor Glen, right? So instead, okay, of building, spelling units there, so that was...
Okay, that just, I was thinking it was money that had come from CPC originally.
Also, and there are mechanisms for a community preservation committee to fund, to put money into a trust, in, you know, to give money, other towns do it, we give it to us, and then it's used for affordable housing. It's not necessarily, it could be used for purchase of land, it could be for other affordable housing uses, so there is a mechanism for money to flow from a CPC into an account that is required to be on affordable housing, but not necessarily with the same thing, as if CPC disperses funds to buy a specific, to buy a piece of land. Mm-hmm. So then it has, there are no constraints on it. But there are other ways for, so even if the money did come from into the trust from CPC, it wouldn't necessarily, unless it was specifically talked about for land, wouldn't necessarily have those strings on it.
Can I go to the members of the public?
I just have a question following that up. Mr. Kay, there is such an account, if I'm not mistaken, that was set up just recently for SMOT to use CPC funds if it became necessary. Was that just limited to the properties that are only...
For distressed properties only.
The distressed properties only.
That's only
on
for
the SHI.
What? That are already on the SHI, not for the creation of the units.
Thank you. I just wanted to make sure.
SHI is a subsidy.
This gets confusing, so it's hard for us to keep track.
So I want to give the patient members of the public a chance to comment. I think I'll start with Ms. Winkler, assuming.
I think you all have my letter from today, so you know the issues that are of concern. Hopefully, they've been shared with CPC and SMOT, because I think they're important questions. And I would just hope you also saw the email from the Soros, Dr. Jean-Claude and Carol Soros. It came in this afternoon sometime, Maureen, I don't know. And it went to Selectmen. You want me to forward it to you? Because she copied me on it, too.
What was the gist of it?
They basically asked that you very seriously consider the questions raised in my letter to you, that they think it's a very inappropriate use up there, and they feel that the significant development going in across the street on McPherson's property is already changing. You should read it. She says it better than I can say it. I'll forward it to Maureen if she can get it to you guys in case it didn't go straight to your
email. All right. Well, this isn't the public hearing anyway, so I guess there's really no harm in that. I know Mr. Thorson wanted to say something, oddly.
Sure. this is not the public hearing, but the suitability of that property, just starting back, I live at 243 Boxboro Road. So the hammer hub law, as we're talking about with that driveway, it actually now is currently permitted for a single family home coming there. So, you know, I moved from 581 Great Road to that area, significant investment in that property to have more privacy than I had before at 581 Great Road. Now we're talking about putting a road to serve something like this type of a multifamily housing. I have no objection to affordable housing in Stow, and we spend the money to do that. But we need to think about where we are placing it and how we are investing. This does not, the justification of a affordable price for this property, I'm very much struggling with. As a town, we spent $340,000 for 323 Great Road for a fire station that we then turned into a park. We have a 50-acre lot available on Red Acre Road for $725,000. I'm sure that can fill over 10% of our affordable housing by buying that. That's a $15,000 per acre of that lot. What we are talking about for these two lots on Boxboro Road is over $20,000 an acre. So, you know, this is a poorly thought out project that's put in here. And as a consequence of this type of project being put in place, I actually have severe concern about the valuation of a property that I invested in less than 2 years ago. I think my property valuation would significantly go down as a consequence of having a road going through my property right now. So I really, you know, ask people that are thinking about this to seriously consider what we are talking about. And I don't think this is a good use of this property, and I'm not appropriate at all.
Thank you, Avi. Any other members of the public on this? Nancy.
I just have a quick question. So the CPC put money towards the non-buildable part of the land, is that correct?
Yes.
It's not, we don't know if it's buildable or not, but the landlocked part.
Right. So it would be the least buildable, and if affordable housing is a goal, why was the CPC money not put towards a lot that truly you could build upon? Okay.
Our intent, again, was that we were trying to find the best solution at the time, given that we wanted to make sure that SMOT had plenty of flexibility so that were they to find for some reason that they weren't going to go forward with this project, that it would be, they would have more options regarding lot three, which is the hammerhead lot. As soon as the CPC gets involved, the project is restricted to our uses as defined by the state.
So that back lot fit your uses best?
So the back land was the least likely to be easily disposed of in some other way. Mm-hmm. So it wasn't that it suits us best, it's that it was that we were interfering the least with the flexibility on the other parcel.
Okay. I see. Just Okay.
Patrick Holmes, buyer at 241 Lot 1A. So with the purchase of the unbuildable portion, as we're referring to it now, if the SMOT development did not go through, I, as the potential buyer now, would not be able to purchase that land in the future for private use.
I guess
if it's purchased with the CPC funds, then that land is dead to the world and nobody can touch it.
It would be.
Well, it could be purchased with a conservation restriction.
But the conservation committee already said that they don't want it because they can't get to it because of the marsh.
A conservation restriction is different from the conservation commission owning. So you can have a property with a conservation restriction on it that is privately owned.
So you could just leave.
Okay. So another point is that you earlier stated, Mike, that you're only looking at the purchase of the land now.
Sir, direct the questions to me.
Okay.
And I'll get somebody to answer as appropriate.
So Mike had stated that he's only looking at the purchase of the land and has not yet considered the development costs. Is it really a wise use of the town's money and CPC's funds and SMOT's funds to purchase land that they may not be able to use? I think that's something else that needs to be considered in this whole process.
Mike, do you want to comment on that?
I don't know about the wisdom, but I can't speak to whether it's a, I can give my opinion about whether it's a wise use of the town's money, but that would be a personal opinion. There are multiple options for the development. One of them would be for the town itself to bear the full burden of the subsidy required to build those units. The difference between what it would cost to build them and what it would cost to sell them is the subsidy. And one model of that would be for the town to bear the full cost of that. And that might be the situation where we would come back and ask for additional funding, either for CPC or some other way. There are other ways for that to be funded. Those could be funded through funds that are paid in lieu funds that are paid for that during development, where a developer may pay fees to the town in lieu of building affordable units that then could be applied to the subsidy for these units. Also, there's another option for other development that occurs in town that would normally require a certain percentage of those units being on site, built on site as affordable. They can be, another option is for those units to be built off site. And so that would be another possibility for the way that those could be built and subsidized. So it is way too early for us to be able to say that this is, we could give a ballpark, it could be from zero to a number, but it essentially would be speculation, particularly since we don't know. At this point, what information do you need to
come up with a pro forma in the next 2 months that you don't have and that you expect to get? Yeah, Laura, please.
Okay, Laura Spear from SMOT. It's difficult to say the information is X because we've been advised by the planning board that there is a lot of development on the table, large-scale development that would then fall under the inclusionary zoning, but it's the affordable housing bylaw that we have, where you have six or more units, you would have to have 10% of those units be affordable. So right now, there are so many developments on the table that this is an opportunity for these developers to build off-site on this parcel as a potential. We've also had some informal discussion with developers of housing, affordable housing, ranging everything from Habitat for Humanity to larger scale developers. They too would be much interested in having the land provided, and they would then fund the development of the houses. So we wouldn't have to worry about it. So when you say we have 2 months to give you a plan, I think that's unrealistic. We have so many opportunities on the table, not a plan, but just a
pro forma.
But it could be nothing.
The gentleman's question, right, I think, is, I'm going to reword it, before we skunk their deal, shouldn't we figure out whether we actually think we can build affordable housing on that parcel? Isn't What's wrong with that question?
That's what the engineering funds that Mike was talking about, that's what we're doing. We're assessing what is the potential.
Physical feasibility.
Right, what is the potential of housing, how many units, what can we practically have in place? The how and the who, we don't know.
And we, but we don't anticipate having that available before town meeting.
Right, and I could just say that there's a multi-step process after the purchase of the land that would require, because there are current uses for this land, there's a permitted use, it's for a single dwelling, there would be a number of steps. There would be a proposal, request for proposal, there would be design funds, there would be a normal permitting process. This would need to be a comprehensive permit, you know, 40, friendly 40B type development. There would be a number of steps, and at each of those steps, there would be input from the town, from abutters, from everybody. It's gonna be a town project, so the idea would be, we would aim for a consensus about what is the right thing to do there. Now that property with 8 acres could support 10 houses, but that, I think we're all aware that that is not something that would be tolerable by the abutters. It wouldn't be a great, it's not a great idea. So in that process of asking for permits, we may say, well, this land could support 8 units, but from input from both what we can afford and what we can, and what is tolerable by, you know, for traffic reasons, for number of reasons, safety reasons, all those reasons, that number may be trimmed down to a much smaller number of units that's more palatable all around to our neighbors. So to actually a pro forma saying, well, we can have from 2 to 8 houses, it would be essentially, there would be so little detail at this point that it would, I don't know that it would be useful to put a lot of effort into creating a pro forma. Does that make sense?
I think so. I mean, there's, and I want to open it up to the members of the honorable board. I get everything you're saying, and I understand how smart, I'm speaking just me, I understand how it's perfectly legitimate to buy a piece of land, and if it doesn't work out on that parcel, you sell it, you use the money for affordable housing elsewhere. Here, there's this added element of, we're doing it at the price of someone else's deal. We're skunking their deal, and it just seems like that adds another element of urgency, need to be certain as possible, and you're saying we can't be any more certain than we already are.
Right. Yeah, I think the town has to look at it from, oh, sorry.
Actually, can I, well, no, please.
I would look at it from the opposite, which is I would do a due diligence process, which I think could be completed in time, that would determine whether there's a fatal flaw in it or not, either for infrastructure, which is water and sewer, we got basic ones, setback requirements, need our bylaws, zoning and construction. If there's no fatal flaws there, because you're going in speculating to some degree, the question is the risk probability for you or every individual that votes too high or not?
Right.
But I think if you're able to answer that question, which is, are there any fatal flaws here, meaning something that can't be managed, whether it's 4 units or 6 units as opposed to 0 units, it's the zero, I think, that you want it, that measurement. If you can't measure it, you can't manage it. But so rather than trying to answer all those detailed questions, I think if you were able to come in, I'm thinking of myself as a voter now. I mean, affordable housing, we have money for affordable housing purposes. This could be funded, right? The question is, are we gonna get affordable housing? Well, what's the risk probability? Well, first of all, we can cite a septic, we can cite water, we can get the setbacks, the zoning satisfied, and the planning board's told us everything they know about this site. Here's what they would anticipate through their experience. You get that answered, I think you're asking too much to say, well, how many units, what's the cost? But if that is the threshold, then you may not vote for it.
No, maybe that is the answer to the due diligence that I'm kind of looking to have happen. Mr. Burke.
I just want to start off by saying that every time the town, or any town, exercises their option to buy, it, in a sense, skunks a deal.
Sure.
So that's just on the table as part of the process. Having said that, I just want to give my thoughts for what they're worth, if anything. I first want to commend the rapid response team and the town administrator for getting this set up so quickly and to be so far along the process, even though, as our chair points out, it's nowhere near what we hope the process is going to be at some point. The the constraints that were put on you were not put on, were not yours. We got notice of this and brought it to your attention rather late. I think what we're focused, or have to be focused on right now, and a lot of these thoughts are going to be expressed at the public hearing, is that should the town exercise its option, given the fact that there is an expressed interest, one of the members or the departments of the town, for an approved usage. And that's the only thing that's on the table for 2 weeks from now. I understand Ms. Winkler's concerns. I read the letter that was sent out to us just shortly after our last meeting, and some of the points made about whether this was legal use or fair use, but I also read our town council's response. That kind of satisfies me. The June 14th letter that I just saw today, because I came in early to read our correspondence, I didn't get it before, but I got through part of it. I think it's very well written, as was your previous correspondence, Ms. Winkler. I just don't know if these are concerns at this point that are addressed to the either the public hearing or to the town meeting. It's, you know, these are all good points, and I hope SMOT and CPC takes a look at it, but I don't think they're really to the point of our public hearing at the next meeting, which is there a sufficient valid interest in a parcel given its potential feasibility? And I just don't fault you guys for not being able to give us 100% assurances either today, 2 weeks, or maybe even in August. I think it's something that has to be worked out over time. Having said that, and I'm very mindful of what the town administrator said, are you going to be able to give us any kind of assurances to feasibility at the public hearing 2 weeks from tonight? Or can you give us a range of probabilities? I mean, well, or you don't even know.
Probably, but I'd say, given what we know right now, that Bill, Lot 3, there's no reason that we have seen nothing about Lot 3 that said that it is not, that it can't support, multiple units. And with Lot 3 and Lot 2 together, that makes it much more, that to me, makes the risk that much lower, because the idea of being able to site infrastructure, the infrastructure that we discussed on Lot 2 and the building on Lot 3, makes it that a very low risk that it can be done. Now again, whether that's financially feasible and whether that's tolerable by, you know, abutters and preferable to the people in town, and whether it's, we're going to meet all those permit things, we can have some sort of conceptual thing to show that something can work there. But in terms of whether all those pieces are going to come together into, you know, by in a month or so, or 6 weeks, I don't know that we're going to have that level of clarity. But our focus has been, as Bill said, is looking for a reason that it, you know, some reason that it's not going to work. And at this point, we've not found that.
And assuming that you don't find a reason it's not going to work within 2 weeks, you'll be asking the town to put this on the town meeting. So you're going to have to submit a warrant before by June 21st.
Correct.
But you'll be asking town meeting to vote not whether or not there's going to be affordable housing there, not how much affordable housing, correct, but whether or not it's in the town's interest
to exercise the option.
I know I'm a slow talker, but let me finish my thoughts before I lose them. To exercise the option with the potential to realize, if possible, that kind of a development.
Oh, I want to give Ms. Hageman and Ms. Hageman first.
I think what would be helpful for the hearing would be to identify the age of the engineering study that's currently available, whether the perk testing is relatively recent. That would sort of indicate that the site, the three, lot three, is in fact
has the value proposed, and I'm assuming since there's a buyer that it does, but I think that would be helpful to have that information. And whether there's any information on well data, and whether you can have some, I mean, I concur with Mr. Wrigley's comments about what you can provide by August 8th, and but there is a lot of information, and I don't know if you, I'm not completely familiar with the process that you have to go through, but whether you can get a perk test on the other back lot within the next 2 weeks, and whether that indicates high groundwater conditions or whatever.
That's the intention.
Okay, so the that's the kind of information that I would want to see as part of a public hearing process, to see what's real, what are we really investing in. So I think that's the kind of stuff that would be helpful, having that detail.
So I just want to say, I think that, and what Mr. Wrigley said, that's addressing my concern. I agree, and I see. You can't, by August 8th, have all the answers. But if we can just try to minimize the risk of doing some engineering, knowing it's somewhat reliable, to minimize the risk that, you know, the day after town meeting exercise the option, we say, oh, you know, affordable housing isn't going to work here.
Just to add to that, I'm sorry, I forgot your name, but you had indicated earlier that there was a concern about access and sharing your driveway. So I think if there could be some discussion about that, that would also be helpful.
That was my concern.
Oh, sorry.
Yeah. Talk about that.
So you can say it.
You know, I have a concern. I know that in most cases, a hammerhead lot is required to be a certain size because of access restrictions and things like that. And I'm wondering, I don't know what the access is, other than I've heard tonight that it's a shared driveway.
Correct.
I don't know if it's a right-of-way that isn't ever going to be able to be a road. I'd suggest you strongly look into that, because if the only access is a right-of-way that's a shared driveway, it may definitely not be suitable for multiple units. That could be one of what, as Bill said, is one of the fatal flaws.
Correct.
And, you know, I share Jim's concerns at the same time, you know, as far as, yeah, I don't want to, skunk somebody's deal, but at present, you know, I'm willing to support your request that we take the next step.
Right.
But I think you've really got to try to get as many answers as you possibly can. But that's what this whole process is all about. You know, people have reaped the benefit of low taxes, but you know what? We get first dibs. So.
So I do need to try to bring this meeting to a close, or this item to a close. There really is no, Laura?
Just one parting thought. I know we're very focused on this one parcel and keep coming in for one specific parcel, but I do want everyone to make sure that we have a factual basis, if you will, of how we're doing for affordable housing. So based on the last census, we need a total of 179 units on subsidized housing inventory, and we are 80 shy. And then when you start talking about 2020 census projections, we will need 280 affordable units on the SHI. And that would make us, at the current rate, 101 units shy. So I just want to set that context, that we are doing what we can through things like our housing production plan update, these small one-off opportunities to try to at least keep at safe harbor.
Mr. Burke,
Very brief, Mr. Chair. I understand those concerns. I understand what's driving the process. But to echo my former colleague, our beloved former colleague, Mr. Curran, you know, those inventories, nobody's hitting those targets anywhere.
Oh, yes, they
are. Well, on a regular basis?
Oh, yes, they are.
Some people are. Lincoln.
Hudson,
Marlboro.
Bedford. Lincoln.
My understanding is the vast majority are not hitting that.
We're a tiny bit off topic. Thank you.
Well, I'm just addressing Ms. Pierce.
There is, and that was a valuable point, and thank you. That is important context. There is really no, there's nothing for us to vote on tonight. I think it's fair to say we have heard a legitimate municipal a potential legitimate municipal use. We have heard an expression of interest from the CPC, though it's a bit of a moving target, it is an expression of interest. Ms. Winkler, Otley, those others who are concerned, you have to understand at this point, our threshold question really is whether or not to move it forward to town meeting so the town can decide. That is a very low threshold to overcome. So that is where we are coming from. This was just an update. Once again, the formal public hearing on this will be on June 28th. And I thank all of you who came here for this item for coming out. Our next item is the town administrator's report, and I will be surprised if we haven't covered just about everything.
Nashoba?
Oh, I apologize, Mr. Town Administrator.
If you want to give me those figures, I'd love to see them.
Well, good, because I'll shorten my accusing report, but one more.
There you go. I skipped over an item, which was a discussion on the nominee for the Nashoba District collective bargaining. Mr. Burke is going to bring clarity to this subject.
I think the chair overestimates my ability. Look, all I can say is I want to especially commend and appreciate the efforts of school committee member Mr. Jones, who's here with us tonight, for pointing out that the way municipal representation to the school district has been handled in the past, even under my watch, may have been, probably was, not properly handled. I'm glad that we now have the regulations that Mr. Jones presented to us about how the actual representative from the three member towns and regional school district is processed and submitted. I think having said that, I think it's also fair to say that what we've done in the past has been, if not entirely correct, has not been that far off the mark. The statutes that have been presented and the regulations have been presented said it's the boards of selectmen or the town administrators choose a representative to the district's negotiating or school contract negotiation or teachers' contract negotiation matters, and that probably should have been emphasized more in the past. Having said all that, we had a discussion about this at Tri-Town last week. My understanding, and I'm going to have to rely on Mr. Jones for the real clarity here, is that the school district has requested that the member towns appoint jointly or cooperatively a representative to represent the interests of the towns on the union contract negotiations, that the town administrators declined to appoint one of their own number. Do I understand that correctly, Mark?
At the recent Tri-Town, right, there's no particular action that occurred.
And at Tri-Town, and you were there, you can correct me if I'm wrong, the upshot was all the member towns were going to go back and put this on their agendas and consider it. But we had one volunteer, that would be Selectman Stan Wysocki from Bolton, who did offer to do that. If the town administrators want to huddle again, I don't think they need to do it in open session. If they want to make recommendations to the various boards, if they can find somebody not only more skilled and experienced, but more willing than Stan, that's fine with me too. I think that's where we are at this point.
So, good opportunity to toss it to the town administrator, I think has a recommendation. Just let me make sure my colleagues understand what we're talking about, that people in the audience know we're talking about. Nashoba is entering into collective bargaining, I assume with teachers and probably non-teacher personnel. The three towns get to nominate, get to name one joint representative who participates in those negotiations. I don't know if he or she actually has voting power or not, but they get to participate. And we're talking about the process by which that person gets selected. Statute seems to indicate that the three town administrators, at least initially, get to either one of them serves or they nominate someone in their stead. Mr. Town Administrator, you have something to add here?
I think I do. To begin with, to be accurate, when I arrived here 24 years ago, the statute provided expressly that it was the chairs of the respective boards of selectmen who chose one of their own. The law simply changed as a practice it never got caught up to.
Right.
But as I read the current CMR and 150E, I think it's clear, though there are some people who don't think it's as clear, that they added town administrators and town managers in front of boards of selectmen now, so that the boards of selectmen, through their chairs, only get to assign one of their own as the municipal representative if the towns do not have a town administrator or town manager. Because Chapter 150E, which is what the CMR is driven off of, through definitions, decided when they changed the law that chief executive officers were town administrators and town managers. Prior to that, executive officers were the selectmen. So 150E, which is the collective bargaining labor statute, defines chief executive officers. That term is then put into the CMR and clarified to say chief executive officers, i.e. town managers, town administrators, or in towns where they have no such positions, it defaults to the selectmen. So this approach is, in my opinion, and I think Mark reads it the same way as does others, that's what it says and what it means. And so if you agree, and I've given you a copy of the relevant sections of this the statute and the CMR, if you read it differently, fine. My reading is that the process is that the district superintendent calls a meeting for the three of us to come to in open session. We appoint one of our own to be the municipal representative. That municipal representative, one of the three town administrators, can delegate if they wish to anyone they'd like. And so as a practical matter, in the event that we have some competing interests and needs here, and then maybe a selectman, one or more, that would like to continue the tradition, what I would advocate is to follow the process as prescribed by statute and CMR, and simply that TA that's we appoint as that position delegates to Stan or someone else if that's what you want it to be, rather than getting into a lengthy discussion that may, if you want, we get an attorney to discern this, but I'll ask you the plain reading of the language. Please look at it and tell me that you come up with a different interpretation, and if you do, I don't want to argue it myself. I'm coming up with an approach. If you'd like something different, I'm happy to let you guys figure it out.
So it should first be noted that our own Selectman Hawks was the joint representative in the last round of collective bargaining. He has expressed interest in continuing that role if asked. Does anyone disagree with the proposal that the town administrator has made, that basically the three of them will get together with the superintendent and they will drag one of their own number to be the...
We have a volunteer, and we have for some time.
Don?
I won't mention any names.
Oh, sorry.
Mr. Chair, I read the statute. It says, in the case of a regional school district, said chief executive officers or chairman of boards of selectmen, as the case may be, of the members, cities, and towns, shall, in accordance with regulations to be promulgated, elect one of their number to represent them pursuant to the requirements of the section. Yes, chairman of the board of selectmen comes second. Can I just finish, Mr. Chair, just so I don't lose my train of thought? Just because the chairman of the board of selectmen comes second, I don't think that means they have a lesser. I think there's just a great deal of leeway given to the towns.
The sentence above that says, if there is no town manager or town administrator in the town, talking about not a regional district, but a single district.
Right.
So they don't repeat that because it's clear they just said that.
But here's the point I didn't want to lose, Mr. Chair, which is, let's all just get along. I mean, if the town.
Then let's follow this process. We'll get you a selectman, we can get out of here, we'll be done.
Brian, what's wrong with the process he's proposed?
Nothing. If the town administrators want to get together and talk about it, if they can find somebody, but I think, but I just don't want to lose the prerogative that I think the statute gives equal prerogative to the boards of selectmen at some point in the future. Having said that, I think I've said, and I'm on the record as saying, I got no problems with the town administrator's plan. I just think that it's something that we've always worked out in the past, and just because there is a new statute, and I'm glad I found out there's a new statute.
Well, it's over a decade old.
Oh, it's over a decade old. The regulations are before 2009?
It's over 10 years old for this change. I mean, like I said, when I came here, it was that.
Well, again, I'm very grateful for the Mark Jones to bring this to our attention. If we need to follow a new process, that's fine. But I still think that, and we can differ about the interpretation of the statute, but I don't think it's necessary for town council. As long as the town administrators get together and then report back to the boards with whether or not they can come up with some kind of voluntary assignment.
Well, I know we have one. Here's what my fear is. Because at this moment it seems to me that there is at least one selectman, maybe two, that would like to continue on the tradition. And given that we have at least one school committee member, which has to be from our own town, expressing the fact that we should clear this up, go forward per the chapter in the CMR that relates to 150E, I think we should clear this up. If there's a different reading, rational reading of this, let's get it out there and try to get a consensus, because this will come up again.
And it will come up again, and that's the time that we can, or if it comes up as a problem this time, that's the time we can get to town council. But right now, I'm fine with the town administrators meeting and seeing if they can't agree to somebody. And if there's a problem, then they can come back to us. But I don't expect that there will be one.
Well, at this point, I suspect there's at least two selectmen that want this job.
I do think that the phrase, said chief executive officers or chairman of boards of selectmen, as the case may be, refers back to the prior sentence.
As I read it the same way as you do, Mr. Chair.
Yeah. So, and we can short circuit all of this because it actually, even under the alternative reading, it doesn't give any authority to the board, it gives it to the chair. So I hereby delegate whatever authority I have or may have to the town administrator. So.
Well, and if you look at the CMR, it again makes clear if you have no town manager or town administrator, then it goes back to the old, which is the.
But in a more substantive, I mean, I am more comfortable, frankly, with a town administrator participating in this process. It mostly occurs during the day. They are the professional administrators. I have every confidence that they will keep all three towns informed. I don't see a downside to this process.
I don't. It doesn't go on during the day.
3 o'clock, right? Isn't that?
Well, they've had it during the day. They've had it in the morning. Okay. They've had it at 3 o'clock. You don't typically find evening meetings.
And that's the key. So, but anyway.
I've done. We've had them in the evening.
I think we.
I will tell you this.
The process though.
I'm not interested in the job. A, and B, this is as far as I want to go, but what I don't want to do is if there's an individual selectman, even one, that feels that this is not a proper reading of the law or would like the job despite the fact that it's the law, I don't want to get into, I'm giving you my proposal, there's three towns involved, you can bring it back to Tri-Town, you can do what you'd like with it, I'm giving you my best shot, my best judgment at what the expressed and implied intent is. And that my solution would be is follow what it, I think it plainly means. And then if you want to get a selectman delegated, then our appointed municipal representative would be a fool, especially if it was one of his own selectmen, not to delegate that to the selectmen and we move on.
So, and you've talked to Mr. Hawks. He's the only one who's expressed interest in actually playing the
role. Yeah, and I told him that my reading of it is this, and he understood.
Understood.
He was interested, but he wasn't saying he was going to. I think it's the individual selectman from who was at the Tri-Town stand who had expressed interest. If he still has that interest, you know.
Well, there can be, at that point, there can be discussions amongst the town administrators on who might be more...
Right, Stan can let them...
Who might be more qualified.
Pick, so...
I'll persuade the other two to make me their representative and then give it to him.
I'm totally okay with the interpretation.
Tom, you're okay with it. I'm okay with it. Brian?
I said I'm okay with it. Just work it out.
Then I think we need a motion. Or do we just instruct you to do as you...
You don't have to do anything. I'll try to follow that process, get a meeting set up for us. We can take our vote, and if it's not followed, or I mean, we have no authority here, so we can do our thing, let you know we've done it.
Right.
If the collective boards of selectmen would like to do something different, we've done our job, and we can go do whatever you'd like.
We can put Don and Stan in a room.
You may consider yourself so instructive, I guess. All right. Our next item is the town administrator's report. Now it's appropriate.
Okay, so what do I have left? And where is it? Here it is. So the first item is taken care of. This meeting that has been scheduled for Arlington on the 20th for Minuteman. And this meeting was the idea of my counterpart in Lexington, Carl Valente. After Belmont voted to disapprove the proposed Minuteman school building project, by district agreement, it shot the entire thing down. All nine other towns had passed it, but it requires unanimity. Belmont passed it down. After their town meeting vote disapproving the project, Lexington asked that they, Arlington and Needham, meet with Belmont representatives just to ask what their thinking was in defeating it. Belmont shared with them what their thinking was, and I'm characterizing it based on an email I got from Carl when I asked him, you know, what was the nature of the discussion with them in disapproving it. Evidently, they are in the process of attempting to renovate or perhaps new build a high school themselves. Belmont is, so they have, this is a second project. They, similar to what I think our finance committee did at our special town meeting, when you get into a square foot cost for this proposed project, it's steep, all right? And so Belmont was thinking, if our cost estimates for our own high school are about half the square foot cost of this one, for an order of magnitude more students, right? Because Belmont has a small number of students, and when you look at the cost, not just on a square footage basis, but per pupil basis, the taxpayer says, well, I guess, how is it we would have to pay so much more for this than we're paying for our own, and would we do it? In other words, I think the question was asked at Belmont from someone saying, would we spend this kind of money per student on our own? And the answer was, we don't think so. So then how is it would be fair that we do it? That's the essence of it. My understanding also, so Belmont shared with the representatives from those three district communities that they didn't think that on a revote they would approve it. All right, so now what? I believe either it was inferred by one side of the table or implied by the other that Belmont might want to ask out. So this meeting that's coming up on the 20th, that was an invitation from one TA to the rest, but also inviting selectmen from each town, is going to be for the purpose of hearing from Belmont again. I'm not quite sure what comes out of that meeting, and I'll be truthful with you. I don't make the policy in this town, and that both those questions are probably policy related. I'll go, I'll listen, come back and report to you what was said. I don't think there'll be any decisions made, obviously. But it's how to reconcile this choke point, which is we've got a community that voted to disapprove, and right now they're not indicating that it comes back. at the current cost and size, I think were the appropriate instructive words. In other words, and I think what Minuteman told us through the superintendent after that is that they bought some time from MSBA, but I think the memo we got from the superintendent is that we don't intend to change our project. That what you voted, you know, meaning to say hopefully we can get Belmont to change, Belmont's saying unless you change the scope and cost of that project, they don't see themselves changing their vote. So we're at a choke point, there'll be a discussion of that, and I'll report to you what.
Well, and the MSBA's indicated that they're not willing to accept any a school any smaller. So.
Well, I won't comment on that, but my experience tells me they weren't going to give us, I think we heard they wouldn't give us another extension. How many times were you there?
Right.
Yeah, this was the last one. Well, it was 180 days. Look, we understand how this works, right? There's mutual interest involved. I'm not criticizing, I'm just saying I would.
Mm-hmm.
That facility committee, unless you wanted me to go with any instructions or if one of you wanted to attend and represent if they ask for a show of hands or anything, I'll leave that to you guys. I did want to update you that I've, with regard to new hires, based on the budget that you approved that I submitted with regard to starting with the planning board, an assistant planner is needed. With all deliberate speed, Jesse moves up upon the retirement of Karen. So they're hiring team, they have a hiring team, and in one case it included the chairman of the planning board. I think for the assistant planner, not necessarily the administrative assistant. You know, Jesse and Karen, I think Castor served on one or both of those. They gave me all the things that I asked for. I'm supporting that recommendation for hire. I wanted to let you know that. Within the step schedules that we've got, well-experienced, credentialed, and I think we compete well for towns our size in what we pay and the level of our staffing and what we do. I've been doing this for a long time in towns under 10,000. We're in the top 25% in those, so you'd expect it, and they did get some qualified candidates and a fair number, and so they've made that choice. Valerie, and I'm not going to be able to pronounce, O-O-R-T-H-U-Y-S, Valerie. And Valerie is for the full-time assistant planner, and then there is the part-time, as you know. We had the GIS employee part-time that we had been funding. And so what they wanted to do is combine GIS with administrative assistant duties. And those two together for 15 hours a week. Again, I agreed to their recommendation for Linda Grenier. And both those will begin in July. The third recommendation to me was from the rec director. If you remember 2 years ago, worked out a deal with the rec commission to split evenly the cost of a part-time administrative assistant because they were the only full-time department with no help administratively. After some discussion, rec commission agreed to that split. Rec not being adequately staffed, didn't even have time to go through the process of getting one. We finally did get one, and that hire for Kimberly McKenzie, again, yes. Part-time, and she's going to step in and provide some relief to the director, and there's enough work to go around there for at least a part-time administrative assistant. So I approve those three. And the last piece is for executive session.
Okay, thank you. Let's do liaison reports. Let's keep in mind when doing these reports that we have an executive session ahead of us. So I will start on my left, Mr. Burke.
Well, given the fact that we have executive session ahead of us, given the fact that I haven't been reappointed to any of my liaison positions, I have nothing to say, really. you can watch Tri-Town. It was broadcast last week. My mother-in-law got to see me in the shirt she bought me. And you've already heard from the bulk of CPC last night.
Thank you. All I have is Library Building Committee met, had its kickoff meeting with the architect that we voted to retain at the last meeting, and next thing they're starting work on a concept plan. Some confusion about whether the HVAC project is two separate projects, two projects within one project. I think that may be getting clarified with Mr. Rigby.
You want me to clarify for you?
You know, no, because it didn't seem like it really made a lot of difference.
I know, obviously I'm not as able to communicate as effectively as I thought I was, because I've done it four times and I'm still getting questions, I don't get it. But anyway,
so
it works.
Yeah, some other time. And I had another thing and I can't remember what it was, so it doesn't matter.
Obviously not that important.
Obviously not that important. Mr. Ryan?
Saw my liaisoning with the Historical Commission. They were very happy, you know, to have the input. Thank you guys very much for supporting me. And put in a call today to Chief Bosworth just to check, see, and he said that he just left me a voicemail basically saying that things are going good down the lake so far. No issues with our appointment, so great. I figured just bring that up.
Thank God we heard about Lake Boone.
Yes.
Well, Don wasn't here to contradict me, so I'm good.
Someone should at least say Japanese not me, so. Ingeborg, I assume you don't have anything.
I have nothing.
Okay. And before we go to the motion on executive session, next time we will be discussing liaison assignments. I had to kick it to June 28th because we could be gone.
I'm going to be gone. I'm moving my daughter to D.C., but what I can do is give you my...
Your list.
My interests, okay?
Ingeborg, if you want to be gone for that meeting, when we're...
Oh, no!
I wish you and your daughter all the best.
Well...
Yes.
Ingeborg, I'll protect your interests.
Thank you. Come on.
Sure, give me your wish list. Do that.
Suck up, my daughter.
No, you'll be fine. You'll be fine. We basically have to see how many of Charlie's assignments Ingeborg is willing to take on. Don is a bit overburdened, but he gave me his list, and really he just wants to give up one thing. I think it may be easier than we anticipate, but please, Maureen, it'd be great if you could send out the current liaison assignment list again, even though we all have it somewhere, and that will facilitate that discussion. So I'm interested in a motion on an executive session at this point.
I move to go into executive session pursuant to Chapter 38 of Mass General Laws, Section 21A3, for the purpose of conducting strategy sessions in preparations for negotiations with non-union personnel, and for discussing strategy with respect to litigation, and to adjourn immediately thereafter, discussing such matters in open session being deleterious to both purposes.
Second.
Motion is made and seconded to go into executive session for the purpose of conducting strategy sessions with non-union personnel and for discussion strategy with respect to litigation. We will not be returning to open session. This requires a roll call vote. I'll start on my right. Ms. Hegeman.
Aye.
And Mr. Ryan. Mr. Burke.
Aye.
The chair votes aye. We're in executive session. Thank you.